Hello and welcome to Let's Read the Books of Enderal. I'm Amethyst Lunatari. Today I'll be reading The Butcher of Ark, Volume 4, Ashes, which I found right here in an abandoned house at Fargville Harbor. Chapter 4, Ashes. It must have been around 2 o'clock at night when I put my plan into action. The voices from downstairs had started to fade around midnight, but I did not want to take any unnecessary risks. Cautiously, I set foot outside my room and peered into the hallway leading to the stairs down to the tap room. However, I quickly withdrew at the sound of stumbling on the stairs. I closed the door behind me and listened. A woman and a man, likely drunk, judging by the irregularity of their steps. Could it be one of the two brutes? No. His voice sounded too bright, too soft, and too tired. I waited until they had passed my room and I heard a door opening and closing. Then I snuck out into the hallway again. Now it was deserted. I crept towards the stairs and peeked down to the tap hall. Nobody. Even the maidservant and the host appeared to have retired for the night, and only the typical smell of grease, alcohol, and sweat reminded of the patrons who had indulged themselves a few hours ago. I nodded contentedly, as if to reassure myself, and returned to my room once more. If the tap room was empty, chances were that there was nobody outside either, with the possible exception of a sentinel. Perhaps a beefy farmer's son who wished to earn a few extra coins. Carefully, I checked the utensils I had gathered for my revenge before I tied the leather pouch containing them around my waist. I pulled the hood of my vagabond's gear low over my face and congratulated myself with its purchase again. The window was open without effort or noise. I pushed the blinds which ought to protect the room from the cold of night open. Just a soft creaking. Slowly I climbed on the windowsill. A soothing, almost thumping warmness spread through my insides despite the cold wind. It was as if I drew power from that strange, dull feeling in my stomach. I looked down the wall and surveyed the situation, filled with a sense of gratification. Indeed, I was less muscular and strong than the brutes, but I was agile and flexible instead. My hands were long and slim, perfectly suited for my purpose. I was lucky in two ways. First, the host had given me a room on the second floor, not the third. Secondly, just a few feet below me was the roof of a small porch, which probably sheltered the sentinel from rain. As I lowered myself from the sill, luck decided to smile on me for a third time. The tips of my boots were only a few fingers' breadth away from the roof. I inhaled deeply and released the ledge. I landed with muffled impact, not loud enough to raise suspicion. Now I had to be quick. Any second out here could be the moment that someone caught sight of me. I snuck along the porch and descended from the edge. A gust of wind made my vagabond's garment flutter, nature's dramatic addition to the scene. The stables where the brutes had left their horses were in front of me. The building was an unremarkable extension of the tavern, standing in the blue of the moonlit night in perfect silence. As I came closer, I heard the heavy breath of horses, the scraping of hooves, and the crinkle of hay. Carefully I pulled at the heavy iron door handle. The door swung open with ease. You might well ask why an unlocked stable door did not arouse any suspicion in me. The truth is that I was too consumed by the blazing determination my bold plan of revenge had ignited to question my fourth lucky streak. I ventured inside without a glimmer of a doubt. Only 5 horses were in the stable, 2 of them sleeping. A gray nag in a compartment next to the door glanced at me with an expression that could have been classified as skepticism, but the animal quickly lost interest and continued to chew on the hay. It was not difficult to find the steeds of my tormentors, pitch black and muscular as they were. They stood at the very end of the horse wing, in a chamber separated by a fragile wooden door. Now the time had come. Cautiously, I knelt in front of the compartment of the first steed, near the manger. I could not suppress a twinge of envy as I inspected the horse from up close. Even an amateur like me could see that it was a Scaragian rock stallion. I quarreled with myself for several seconds. Who were these men that they could afford such noble horses? And what would befall me if they ever got scent of the fact that I was responsible for what would happen to them in the morning? Maybe all this is the first time in your life that you show courage. These two bastards have earned their lesson in humility. Of course. The voice was right. I was right. To recoil now would be an act of cowardice, a shame I did not want to live with. Indeed, these two had earned a lesson in humility, and I was going to give it to them. My fingers slid into the leather pouch at my side, felt out the small phial, and pulled it out. Sheer cap dust. The eponymous mushrooms usually grew in sparsely vegetated, stony landscapes, and the cliff where Fogville was situated on was exactly such an area. The application of these fungi was one of the first things Mother Pilea had taught me when I was a novice. Mixing the dry powder with whisper tree resin resulted in a sticky pulp which accelerated the healing rate considerably when applied to an open wound. Since whisper trees grew in nearly every area of Enderal, except for the barren lands of Thalgard, the Frostcliff Mountains, and the Pinnacle Desert, it was highly advisable to bring a phial of concentrated sheer cap powder on extended journeys. The substance provided protection from various ailments and afflictions, perhaps most importantly inflammation, for those who knew the correct dosage of the two components. However, the cap's powder had an additional effect which was unknown to the common people. If it reached the stomach of an unfortunate fellow in an excessive concentration, it triggered something that would best be described as a cascade of rage. Negative feelings such as grief, hate, and anger were amplified many times over. An irascible man would lose his temper even faster than usual. A gloomy, heartbroken woman would be suffering unbearably to the point of a full breakdown. The effect of concentrated sheer cap powder mixed into a meal equaled the feelings a trained psionicist could evoke in his victims. The only difference was that the powder needed 7 or 8 hours to take effect. In this case, though, I welcomed the delay, as you can imagine. According to my plan, the two brutes, full of arrogance and pride, would be mounting their expensive stallions, only to be thrown to the ground by the befuddled horses in full gallop. The animals would likely run off, leaving the primitives behind with considerable bruises or fractures. Back then, I was shocked by the gratification, or rather arousal, this thought brought me. A smile formed on my lips while I uncorked the phial and walked towards the sleeping horses. I did not have to search long for the trough. It contained a pap of hay, mashed apples, and rancid water. Probably a meal these splendid animals were not accustomed to, yet it was tasty enough to sate their appetite. I crouched down in front of the bucket, which had been placed at the end of the hallway, between the two compartments, poured two small piles of powder on my hand, and mixed it into the food. Once that was done, I carried the trough to the compartment, swung it back and forth in front of the horses, and murmured something I hoped was encouraging to gently wake up a warhorse. I did not have to wait long. The first horse opened one eye and gave me an indefinable glance. Sleepily, it shook its head, as if the mental classification of my presence meant too much effort at this late hour, fluttered its lips, and dipped its head into the trough. It's working! Damn it, it is working! The thrill of anticipation which had vibrated within me when I entered the stable mingled with glowing triumph, and I felt more excited than ever. Strange, indeed. There I was, a young priest of about 30 winters, playing a prank on two brutes who had been bullying me. However, instead of feeling impish or cheeky, I saw myself as an impersonation of justice, an avenging angel who contributed to the betterment of humanity with his action. Well, I admit it was a fairly generous interpretation of the circumstances, and the first butterfly flew, as the veiled woman would say. I was so consumed by satisfaction that I did not perceive my surroundings. I only heard the scuffling of steps behind me when it was already too late. A heavy paw landed on my shoulder. Startled, I turned my head, my first mistake. Now the buccaneer was able to identify my face, which had been concealed by the shadow of my hood. He seemed to realize what I was doing straight away. "You lousy swine!" he snarled, half statement and half question. His breath, reeking of alcohol, was the last thing that registered with me before his right fist clashed into my face. I heard a sharp snap and felt a burning pain shoot up my head. The blow's force threw me back and had me collapse on a sparsely distributed pieces of hay on the floor. My head reverberated as if the pillars of the Sen Temple had dropped down on it. "Miserable son of a whore!" The buccaneer's voice resounded amidst the buzzing that rang in my ears. You haven't had enough, have you? Disoriented from the pain, I attempted to crawl forward, but he immediately felt an exploding pain in my right side as a giant thrust his thick leather boot in my side. Huh? What is your problem, you piece of crap? He shouted, full of rage. What is your damn problem? Another kick followed, this time against my ribs. I could hear them cracking noisily, and for a moment I was unable to breathe. I was foolish enough not to understand that the buccaneer's questions were not questions, but expressions of rage, so I held up my hand and tried to offer an explanation for my presence here. As a result, his boot struck my head, and my face was dashed against the hard stone floor. I felt hot blood running down my forehead, my cheeks and my nose, and for a couple of seconds my vision blackened. Using the last of my strength, I curled up like a child in its mother's womb, in hopes that the position would allow me to endure the force of his attacks. You miserable fool, I thought. You damn fool, he's going to kill you, damn it. He's going to kill you. Over and over, I cursed myself while anticipating the next kick. But no kick came. Confused, I dared to open my eyes and raise my head a little. I could barely make out anything in the dark with all the blood in my eyes. The giant had turned away from me and knelt before his horse, worriedly caressing it. The soothing words he whispered to the animal were in stark contrast to the brutish shouting which had accompanied his assault. He does not recognize me, I realized through the pain. He does not even recognize me as a threat. What happened next, and most importantly, what I experienced, will be hard to put into words. I remember how I suddenly felt the leather sheath of my iron dagger. I had considered it wise to keep it disguised, and had it on me simply because I had forgotten to leave it in my room in the tavern. Everything happened faster than I was able to think, instinctively, bestially. Anyone who had received a well-trained hard blow to the nose knows how painful it is. However, my pain vanished in an instant, and I became aware of how the dull feeling in my stomach, the feeling which had shaped into determination and anticipation at the premise of my failed act of vengeance, began to transform. If a feeling had a form, it transformed after my last thoughts had run their course. Degenerate bastard, first you humiliate me without reason in front of all those people, and now you dare to spoil my revenge? The anger in my stomach smoldered, and in a matter of seconds my body was soaked with sweat. I trembled. He is going to pay for this, the subhuman, the worthless piece of filth that considered himself above the law, merely because of his bloated upper arms and his physique. Indeed, some people do not deserve a place on this world. Quietly, bristling with rage, I drew my dagger. My arm had been strangely twisted by the kicks, but I ignored the pain. It did not exist anymore. It was only me and my enemy. And then I was there. With a force I did not think my slim arms were capable of, I drove the dagger into the brute's back. Surprised and stunned, the gorilla gasped and spun around. Now there was no hint of malice and mocking in his eyes. Instead, I saw bewilderment, as if what was about to happen did not belong to the realm of possibility. Then it changed to plain, bestial rage. He grabbed my throat with both his hands and lifted me off the ground, so I dangled like a convict from the gallows. The dagger stuck in his back as if it had been there from the day of his birth. I felt his strong fingers dig into my windpipe, cutting off my air, but the moment I looked into the man's eyes I knew his end was nigh. It burned inside of me, an archaic, destructive force and a volatile cocktail of rage, euphoria, and a flush of victory coursed through my veins, my mind, every part of my body. With full force I slammed the tip of my boot between his legs. The man let out a tormented wail, released my neck, and doubled over. I did not hesitate for a second. I reached for the hilt of the dagger protruding from his back and yanked it free, only to plunge it into his flesh in a different place. This time I encountered resistance, so I altered the angle of the weapon and turned it jerkily. The man roared, his voice no longer sounding human. Weak and disoriented, he tried to fall backwards and just throw himself on me, but it was in vain. You dare to evade your punishment? The voice in my head ranted. After all you did to me, you dare to resist me? Huh? Once more I struck him with my dagger, driving it into his thigh. Again he staggered, gasping unintelligible words. This time he did not try to fight back. Instead, he sank to his knees and started to whimper. He wants me to stop! An insane, triumphant grin spread across my face. This piece of crap truly wants mercy. However, I did not grant him mercy. I threw myself upon him and knocked him on his side. As I straddled him, it hit me that a stranger, who at this very moment watched our silhouettes, would have considered us a couple in love play. A laugh left my throat, followed by another, louder one. The way he was lying there, the oafish, remorseless giant looked at me with delirious eyes full of fear, like a boy who is about to receive a well-deserved spanking from his father. His steed did not appear concerned in the slightest. "Please, please don't," he whispered, blood gushing from his mouth. What happened then will be difficult to describe. First, I was overcome by a wave of demonic joy and broke out in manic laughter. I threw my head back and laughed loud and ringing. An ecstatic frenzy swept through my bones, my veins, my body. By the Black Guardian, I felt alive. I felt as if I had lived, surrounded by heavy fog, which had only been blown away just now, as if I had taken a shadow on the wall for the thing that was casting it. Like a priest who killed a sacrificial lamb, I took hold of the dagger with both my hands, raised it above my head, and drove it into the brute's chest. In the very instant that the poignant sound of steel penetrating flesh occurred, something transpired that changed my life forever. For a short time, I became the man I killed. Indeed, I became him and stayed myself at the same time, as paradoxical as it may sound to you. A wave of unknown memories swept across my mind. I saw the brute, hands dripping with the blood of a Scaragian man. I saw him in a dark room, holding a black piece of cloth, weeping. I saw him together with his chum. It was his brother, in a large stone hall, standing in a circle of people who held each other's hands. Each of the images appeared with the force of a striking hammer, and with every new image the tingle increased, the flaming delight in my body intensified, and the obsession controlling my actions grew, became more consuming. "Feed me," the dark part of myself cried, louder and stronger with every vision that appeared to me. "Feed me with his flames." With shaking hands and covered in sweat, I withdrew the dagger from the giant's lifeless remains, only to drive it into his chest once more, even more forceful than before. Again, memories that were not mine flooded my mind the moment the dagger sank between two ribs, revealing themselves to me on the rhythm of an adrenaline-fueled heartbeat. Every new image brought ecstasy, building and building until it left no room for other sensations. I uttered a noise that was meant to be a sigh of pleasure, but left my mouth as a manic, demonic croak. By the righteous path, I experienced a feeling of rapture like never before. "I am alive," my thoughts cried, while I lifted the blade for the next blow. "I live, and I judge." The blade dashed down again and pierced the lifeless flesh beneath me. Memories, ecstasy. His red lifeblood splattered on my face and mixed with my own, hot and sticky. But I did not care. No, I cared about nothing at all, for I would judge, kill, punish him for his sins, stab for stab, memory for memory, until nothing remained of him, nothing but cold, lifeless ashes. Even now, almost a year later, my palms grow moist and my breath quickens when I recall this memory. The ink becomes darker and the quill snaps on the parchment. But you will not be able to understand my feelings as a damned being from a non-rational point of view. There are numerous reasons for this. First of all, it is very likely that you are disgusted by my account. You are right to be, for I describe a barbaric act in an almost celebratory manner. However, it is the only way to make you understand my thoughts to at least some extent. The second reason, which is attributable to the first, is the one that carries the most weight. There are things you can only truly understand if you experience them yourself. Among them are sex, the thrill of pain during a deathly fight, and, not least, the end of life itself, death. How exquisitely we can reason upon the latter, creating theoretical models to explain its nature. From the teachings of the path to the chants of the monks from Araziel, or the reasoning of a philosopher's mind, yet ultimately it makes no difference. We will not truly understand it till the moment we face it ourselves. The ecstasy which had gotten hold of my body like the blue death seized a wild mage's mind was all of the above and none of it. It was the fire. It filled me up, burned in every part of my body. My limbs felt boiling hot, and my heart was beating insanely within the confinements of my chest. What I had done seemed morbidly wonderful, lofty, even stimulating, and in a perverted manner, sexual. I did not perceive for a second that I had done anything wrong. No, there was no right or wrong. There was only me and the driving force inside of me, originating from somewhere separate from gods, demons, and the laws of this world. I was judge. My will was my sword, and the brute, the convict. There was nothing more. My movements were instinctive, archaic, pure. What I did were simply the consequences of intricate circumstances. Just like a wolf tearing a lamb apart, I did only what I, J.L. Tannerson, had to do in this moment. At least until the fire expired. How late might it have been? The cock's crow had not sounded yet, but a few birds chirped in the dense forest adjacent to the wheat fields. One of the steeds was still asleep, despite all the ruckus from the night. The other stallion scraped its hooves impatiently over the hay-covered ground. I had not moved a bit after my final stab. The man who some hours ago had mocked me lay beneath me, battered and disfigured. The dark blood on my hands was beginning to dry. Unmoving and rigid as a wax doll, I knelt by my work. At one point, I had experienced a zenith of sorts. As mentioned earlier, I had felt more burning and ecstatic with every stab. The flames inside me had grown, grown and grown, until it was like an enormous infernal pillar of flames had shot up from my stomach to my eyes, blazing, hot, searing. Now my reason was starting to return. Less and less I thought with the diffused voice in my mind. More and more I became J.L. Tannerson again, born in Fogville, a pathless priest and murderer. The realization of what I had done finally sunk in, but like with the warrior, after a nerve-wrecking battle, my mind and body were too spent, too weak from the exertion, to be able to think straight. So I let the dagger drop from my cramped fingers, tilted my head back, closed my eyes, and listened to the silence. 10 minutes passed, 15, half an hour. Only when footsteps approached the stable did I break free from my rigor, but still I found myself incapable of acting accordingly. "A good boy wipes the dirt off his plate," shot through my head all of a sudden. Slowly I shifted my gaze in the direction where the sounds had come from. It was the buccaneer's brother. Briefly the fire lit up inside me again, and I smiled an almost indulgent smile at the man who stared at the carnage in disbelief. Then it dissolved, too tired, too weak, sated. The brute's hand crept towards his sword. Before he could wrap his fingers around the hilt, he dropped to the ground with a choked, gurgling groan. I blinked, too apathetic to fully comprehend what had just happened. A figure, veiled in shadows, loomed still like a statue over the collapsed body by the entrance. Then it moved toward me. A silver beam of the moon, almost defeated by the sun, illuminated the figure's face. It was the bow. He halted a few steps away from me and placed his hands on his hips. He appeared to me like a docker who had examined the payload that had to be carried from the ship to the wharf in hours of hard work. A smile appeared on his face, engaging, perceptive, and scornful. "You actually have it," he spoke in a pleasant baritone. "Fascinated?" "What?" The bow laughed. "Well, what?" He paused, and for a moment seemed to look right through me. Then his eyes met mine again, and I perceived in them a curious change I was unable to comprehend at that time. The fire. Thank you for listening to Let's Read the Books of Enderal, The Butcher of Ark, Volume 4, Ashes.